Alors Alexandre Oparin est le premier.
Alexandre Oparin was the first who attempted in the 20s to define the context in which life was formed on a planet Earth. And he said that prebiotic synthesis, synthesis which happened for life, appeared of living biomonomers, elementary bricks, amino acids, nitrogen bases of nucleic acids, sugars, were formed from constituents contained in the atmosphere of primitive Earth. Aldane, a geneticist, also contributed a few years later to create the scenario, and molecules formed in the atmosphere of primitive Earth allegedly deposited themselves in the ocean to form a primitive ocean, a kind of prebiotic soup, in which all of these compounds came together to form the first forms of cells, protocells, that Coparin called coacervates. Nowadays, in the laboratory, we can reproduce the synthesis of coacervates with thermal condensation, high temperature condensation of amino acids, which can be found in proteins, or through condensation of lipids, fatty molecules, fatty acids, lipids which are called liposomes and are shown here on this picture.
Et pour vous montrer combien ces travaux pionniers sont encore modernes aujourd'hui en laboratoire,
is still very modern today in the laboratory,
de la fusion et la fission
show here the formation, the emerging, the fission of bacteria, wall-less bacteria, L-shaped bacteria, bacilli with no wall. And Errington, a researcher called Errington, showed that these bacteria were capable of dividing and merging exactly like in vitro coacervates. And the L-shaped bacteria are capable of budding in order to form, release offspring that look like droplets, exactly like coacervates. You can see this on the last picture.
Stanley Miller in 1953
rose to the challenge,
possédant tous les éléments de compréhension de l'atmosphère primitive,
because he had everything to understand primitive atmosphere, he wanted to reconstitute the atmosphere in a laboratory. In Harold Urey's laboratory, he got the Nobel Prize for the discovery of deuterium, a hydrogen isotope. Stanley Miller built a machine. And in the upper balloon, he placed methane, CH4, ammonia, NH3, hydrogen, H2, and water, H2O, which he then submitted to electrical discharges. And after some time, he saw five amino acids, which were similar to, identical to amino acids, such as can be found in living cells. A few years later, this conceptual experimental revolution led Juan Oro to obtain in prebiotic conditions with no enzymes based on acid, cyanhydric acid condensation, HCN, submitted to photon bombing. He obtained adenine. Adenine is one of the elementary bricks of nucleic acids, both DNA and RNA. And also in meteorites, a large number of nitrogen bases were found, the bases that come into nucleic acid. Here we have Murchison's meteorite that was formed at the same time as the solar system, 4.5 billion years ago. And many nitrogen bases were found in the meteorite. You can have a recent have a look at a recent paper, 2011, if you want to have all the details of the discovery. Now, a second scenario, which is not incompatible really with that of prebiotic soup, but is more relies more on the role of mineral surfaces in the origin of life. This is Gunther Wachterhauser's scenario. He was preceded by Desmond Bernal and Carl Smith on this path, and the scenario uses clay and iron sulfide as having participated in the formation of chemical molecules. So he
se servant de
uses mineral surfaces, which allegedly play a role, using also other environmental compounds, gaseous compounds. And this is what he calls the chemoautotrophy scenario. Apparently, the very first organisms were chemoautotrophic. And this scenario is also supported by the existence on small volcanic cones, which can be found in underwater hot sources. The small volcanic cones are covered in pyrite, iron sulfide, which reacted with
ayant réagi, donc du sulfure de fer qui a réagi
iron sulfide, which reacted with the sulfur hydrogen.
Évidemment, nous ne sommes pas qu'un sac. Je ne parle que de molécules.
Obviously, I'm only talking about molecules. We're not a bag full of molecules. We're made of cells.
Sur cette image, vous pouvez voir un compartiment qui représente une cellule, à l'intérieur de laquelle s'expriment des macromolécules, ADN,
des oxyribonucléiques acides,
répliqués,
which will replicate in order to give birth to other DNA molecules, transcribed into ribonucleic acid, a close relative of DNA,
une simple petite molécule d'oxygène,
oxygen molecule,
est supprimée dans l'ADN,
is
entre
suppressed
l'ADN et l'ARN,
in DNA, between DNA and RNA, all that is missing is an OH hydroxyl, otherwise the molecules are very similar, and the RNA molecule will be translated in protein,
du ribosome,
within the ribosome.
Complexe,
the ribosome is a huge ribonucleoprotein complex in the cell.
Très longtemps,
now,
comment des
for
molécules
many
aussi
years, the question was asked,
les acides nucléiques,
how can molecules so different, nucleic
sur la
acids
terre
and proteins, how can they appear on primitive
moment,
Earth exactly at the same time, in the same place.
Ce dilemme est en partie résolu.
What the dilemma is about to be solved
dans les années 1980,
thanks to the discovery in the 80s
d'ARN
of an RNA molecule, a very special RNA molecule which possesses information properties. It carries a genetic information, as the nucleic acid would, but also possesses catalytic properties, exactly like proteins.
Un ARN,
so RNA, which is both
et à la fois catalyseur, est appelé un ribosome,
a catalytic converter and an information carrier, and it's called ribozyme. You have a picture
et
here of a ribozyme.
Des ribosomes,
and this discovery of a ribozyme
porte ouverte, si je peux dire,
opened
à
a door
travaux, à considérables
for
travaux,
huge research and huge discoveries around RNAs,
Nobel,
and some people got Nobel Prizes
et aux chercheurs, évidemment,
thanks to RNA discoveries and the researchers who worked on the molecules.
Alors,
and you see the dates on the slide. The discovery of ribozymes led to an assumption which became a real paradigm, the paradigm of the RNA world, which apparently preceded the current world, which is more based on DNA, RNA, and proteins. Based on work conducted within this paradigm borders, many questions were raised. Would it be possible that there is such a thing as a continuum ever since the origin between the RNA world, viroids, viruses, and cellular lineages? One must say today that the border between cells and viruses is fading away. We know we're aware of a very large number of giant viruses. Very recently, in 2013, we discovered Pandora viruses. And also we discovered that parasitism, which was normally reserved to viruses, is actually a property shared with some bacteria. Some bacteria are parasites and behave like obligatory parasites. And because bacteria are living cells, we don't see why the demarcation
en ce qui concerne les virus.
Would
sont des parasites,
not function for
donc,
viruses. Viruses are parasites and therefore they deserve
comme les bactéries d'être
to be considered as living beings, as bacteria. And it was finally discovered that viruses express themselves, they have a metabolism independently of the fact that they infect or contaminate the host cell. The picture you are showing now are Okay, viruses, ATV viruses, which are capable of synthesizing appendices, 800 amino acids, appendices, independently from the fact that they contaminate the cell, so outside of a cell. Viruses do have metabolic activity. And we're also aware of viroids. Viroids are naked RNA, no capsize, no envelope, contrary to normal viruses. And viroids are subviral particles. And some researchers say that these naked RNAs, which can be found absolutely everywhere in nature, are really the remains of an evolution which took place before the era of cells and the current cellular lineages. Adding to that the fact that we only know 1% of the living species on the planet, some are not known, some are listed, but some cannot be cultivated, they cannot be bred and raised in a petri dish, and therefore we don't know their metabolism, we don't know what they're made of, we don't know them. And they only make this 1% of the species that we know only represents 1,000 of the living organisms that ever existed on Earth since the origin 3.5 billion years ago. So we have just seen that there is gradualism here at play, proto-life to life. We can live with viroids, we can live with viruses, we can live with bacteria in different ways. And even on the molecular level, biodiversity exists on all levels. There is biodiversity on all scales, and biodiversity finds its origin in the origin of life.